before we do, if you have your Bible, cell phones, iPads with you, I want you to hold them up and say this after me. Say, this is my Bible. In it are 66 books written by 40 different authors. Its words are God-breathed and God-inspired. It is God's owner's manual for my life. And if I read it every day, it will change my life. It will transform me into the image of Jesus Christ. Therefore, I choose to love it and cherish it all the days of my life. Now turn to the person next to you and say, read your Bible every day. You know, to be transformed into the image of Jesus Christ does not mean that you'll become Jesus Christ or even close to that. But to be transformed in the image of Him means that you will become more like Him every day of your life. You become more like Him because you are in His Word, because you are talking to Him in prayer, because you are fellowshipping with your brothers and sisters in love, and you're hanging out with people, like-minded, simpatico people. And so in that process, you become transformed and become more like Him. You can't become Him. You all understand that, amen? Some cults teach that you can actually become a god. We don't believe that. You can't become a god, but you can be transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. Amen? So getting back to the book of Ezekiel, this morning we're going to be looking at chapter 17. How many of you are enjoying going through the book of Ezekiel? Amen. So if you have your Bibles with you, you can open them there to Ezekiel chapter 17. I want you to put a marker there, and then we'll get back to it in just a few moments, because I have a few points that I want to talk to you about and make before we get into this chapter. So over the course of the study through the book of Ezekiel, we've been witnessing a bunch of encounters that Ezekiel has had with this extraordinary supernatural God. He's the same God you and I serve and worship today. In fact, the Bible says that He never changes, because He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? You can always count on Him. That seems to be the theme of this morning's service. Amen, church? He is a faithful God. And these encounters Ezekiel was having are called visitations from God. And they usually are always followed by some kind of crisis, some kind of eventful crisis that means something. And then God makes these visitations to the prophet Ezekiel and speaks to him so that he could relay a message to the people. God wants the people to have an understanding of what's taking place during this time. So in this particular case, the crisis was that the Hebrew nation in Jerusalem, which is in the southern kingdom, had turned their back on the Almighty God. And they were worshiping these demonic idols. And the Levitical priest who served in the temple brought in demonic idols inside the temple, and they were worshiping these demonic idols instead of the one true God that they were supposed to be worshiping. And God didn't find that very becoming to Him. And so this stirred the anger of a jealous God who has said, "You shall have no other gods before you." And now, because of them participating in all this corruption, the destruction of Jerusalem has begun to happen. It's begun to take place now. And what a terrible, you know, and frightening place to be, right? Turn your backs on God and allow the sinful corruption from the demonic realm enter into a nation. Frightening, frightening place to be. In chapter 17, we're going to see God commit or comment, I should say, on what's actually going on in Judah, in the southern kingdom. And he's going to do it by having Ezekiel tell them a story, which is a parable or an allegory that is going to help them understand what is going on around them. God wants these people to understand what's going on around them so they know why God is bringing destruction upon them and their nation. Remember that because of the disobedience of the people of Israel, the northern kingdom, which was conquered years ahead by the Assyrians, had now start to happen in the southern kingdom because their disobedience towards God had increased over time and increased over time. And now he gives them, the southern kingdom, over into the captivity of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, who invaded the land. And you should, because of our journey through this book, know what is going on up until this point. So I have a map on the very first slide. If you can go to the next slide, show a map of the northern and southern kingdom. And here's this map of Israel, which was divided into these two kingdoms. Israel being the northern kingdom, the capital of Israel was Samaria, and the chief tribe was Ephraim. And then the southern kingdom is Judah, at which the capital is Jerusalem, and the chief tribe in Judah was Judah. And so the northern kingdom, called Israel, sometimes referred to as Ephraim in the Bible, and the southern kingdom called Judah, and the division of the nation, they were once one nation. But the division of the nation was a judgment from God upon them for not keeping God's commands, specifically the commands prohibiting idolatry and the marrying of what the Bible calls strange women. Now, many of you may know some strange women, and I'm not going to go any further than saying that, but the marrying of strange women that is talked about in the Bible, God prohibited that, and these women, strange women, these were women that were idolaters who would not convert to worshiping the one true God. Remember, King Solomon had something like 1,000 wives, right? He was the wisest man in the world, but when it came to women, man, he was the dumbest guy on earth. And so it is said, in Ecclesiastes, that he had like 1,000 wives, and many of them were these strange women. Aren't you glad that we don't have any strange women here at Heritage Church? Say, turn to somebody and say, no strange women allowed. See, Solomon's indulgence in these strange women led him on a path that would ultimately punish all of the ancient Israel. Remember, they were one nation. And so because of Solomon's path, who was the king at that time, it caused this division. It caused God to split the nation, to punish all of ancient Israel, and causing the nation to split into two countries. And so by now this time, or two kingdoms, I should say, by this time, King Nebuchadnezzar took the king of the southern kingdom captive. This is where we're at now. This is where we've been in the book of Ezekiel. So he takes the southern king captive, and he put his own king, Zedekiah, in place, who was sort of a puppet type of a king that just did what he was told to do by Nebuchadnezzar. Sort of like what we got going on today in our nation. Listen, you need to remember this, you guys. The Babylonian army coming into Jerusalem and taking people captive was God's disciplinary action on them because of their disobedience towards him. God allowed that to happen. He was disciplining them. He was trying to wake them up because of where they were at spiritually. They were dead in their trespasses and sins, so to speak. And so turn your Bibles there where you had it marked in Ezekiel chapter 17, verse 1. And here's what it says. It says, "The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, propound a riddle and speak a parable to the house of Israel. Say, thus says the Lord God, a great eagle with great wings and long pinions, which is plumage of many colors, came to Lebanon and took the top of the cedar." So I'm going to try to explain to you what these things. Remember, he's speaking in a parable. He's allegorically telling a story to which they could relate to more easily than we can today. So you need to know that the great eagle is King Nebuchadnezzar. And the top of the cedar that he mentions here is snatched away is the king of Judah. That's who that is. Remember, I said Nebuchadnezzar took the king captive and he brought him to Babylon. And his name was Jehoiakim. And he was replaced by this puppet king that Nebuchadnezzar put in, King Zedekiah. So in verse 4, it goes on to say that he broke off the topmost of its young twigs and carried it to a land of trade and set it in a city of merchants. So here, the city of merchants he's bringing Zedekiah to Babylon, which is the city of merchants. Now, verses 5 and 6. Then he took the seed of the land and planted it in a fertile soil, and he placed it beside abundant waters, and he set it like a willow twig, and it sprouted and became low-spreading vine, and its branches turned toward him, and its roots remained where it stood. So it became a vine and produced branches and put out boughs. I need to stop there and explain what I just read. Explain this to you. When God disciplines us, you guys, we see Him as we see Him disciplining Judah here. Whether you like it or not, it's part of God's plan because of our disobedience, because of their disobedience. Discipline from God is part of His plan, whether we like it or not. If we understand God's discipline and we allow Him to do so, then we will reach this place of maturity so that we can grow and learn from that experience that we just had. Are you with me on that? That's part of the transformation process. It's like when we discipline our kids, right? Neither one of us like it. But if they agree to the disciplinary action and they don't rebel against the discipline, it will cause growth and maturity to take place in them. Amen? Can I get a big amen? Most of you have had kids or grandkids, right? And sometimes you have to discipline them. And if they submit to a parent's discipline, it will cause growth in them down the road. They learn from it. So what we read in verses 5 and 6 was when Judah was aligned with God concerning his disciplinary action, he took the seed, the Bible says, of the land and he planted it in fertile soil. So they were going along. They were in agreement with God's discipline towards them. And so God took the seed of the land and he planted it in fertile soil, so that they would learn and that they would grow from this disciplinary action. And then it sprouted and it became a low-spreading vine, it says. And this is speaking of Judah, of course. So go back to the slide of the northern and southern kingdom that I had up there for just a minute. But what happened during this time is that King Zedekiah, he began to listen to the false prophets of that day, telling them that God was going to save them and that they were the thumb of Babylonian Empire that they were living under. God was going to was going to make that all go away and make things better. So Zedekiah, because of listening to the false prophets, he then reaches out to the king of Egypt and, to try to get help to war against and defeat the Babylonian Empire. He tried to get the king to give him horses and chariots and all that kind of stuff so that he could go to battle with the Babylonians, but he so that he would not be under their rule anymore. And that, my friends, is a foolish thing to do. Now go back to verses 5 and 6 on those slides for a minute. In verse 6, it says, the seed sprouted and became a low-spreading vine, right? So this vine secretly and underhandedly bent her roots towards the king of Egypt to save them instead of allowing God to complete his disciplinary action. Are you with me on that? So by doing so, it was a form of rebelling against God, God's discipline. And how many of us understand when we do that, things begin to get worse and more difficult in our lives? When you rebel against God's discipline, things aren't going to get better, they're going to get worse. God's discipline is in us, he does it in various ways, right? He doesn't discipline us all the same way. So he does it in various ways, and the reason he does is to point out our sin and cause us to deal with it and turn from it and get back with him so that we might overcome that weakness in ourselves. That's why he does that. And when we do, we're one more step, you see, closer to maturing or transforming into the image of Christ. Are you guys with me? However, if we rebel against God and his discipline, God says, okay, I'm just going to reach it, and I'm just going to ratchet up a notch, I should say, until I get your complete attention. I don't know about you, but I've been in that position before where I wasn't listening to God, and he began to ratchet up a notch. I think I may have told you, I've shared this story several times over the years in the church, but I was an assistant pastor, but I was still working full-time in the secular world, and I was an assistant pastor at a church, and it was sort of like I had one foot. God was really blessing me in the secular world and the occupation that I was in. I was making lots and lots of money. And yet, I had a call in my life in the pastoral ministry. And so, I was thinking that I wasn't sure what God was wanting from me because I had this blessing coming in financially, and yet I felt this tug in my heart to move forward in ministry. And so, I'd completed Bible college and all that, I was just staying in this place, the same place for a number of years, and God had his foot in my back and pushing me to get into ministry, and I resisted. So one morning I was in bed, and I woke up at like 3 o'clock in the morning, something like that, and I had the worst pain in my side that I've ever had, ever. And so I get up and I walk downstairs and I start doing what I always do. I start pacing around and thanking God that he's healed me and praising him for his healing power. But the pain kept getting worse. It got so bad that I barely could make it back upstairs and shake Char, who was in bed, to take me to the hospital. So she takes me to the hospital, and when I get there, my appendix broke. It bursted open. And so I had all this poison flowing in my body. Got very sick, and they took out my appendix, but I had all this poison in my system, so I had to stay in the hospital much longer than a normal removal of your appendix would take. And so when I was done at the hospital, They sent me home, sewed me back up, sent me home, and I still had all this pain. I was still very, very sick, laying on my back for a week, and the pain kept getting worse and worse and worse. And so I told Char, you need to take me back to the hospital, and I go back to the hospital, and I had gangrene. And so they opened up the wound, cleaned it all up. I had to go back, lay in bed, and with an open wound that my wife had to clean every day for me a couple times a day, and lay in bed on my back. And one day when I was in bed, laying on my back, I fell asleep, and I either had a dream or a vision or whatever. And in this, I was falling. And I was falling backwards, like this, backwards, back first. And it was darkness all around me, pitch black darkness, like space, like you see those pictures of space. And I was falling backwards, and I remember looking at my hands, and I was falling super fast. And, you know, like a jet stream has, it was going between my fingers. I was falling so fast backwards. And I was looking, and it was like I was helpless, just falling backwards, falling, 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 and falling, 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 falling. I kept falling. I'm falling, and all of a sudden, boom, I hit and land on my back. And I laid there because it was a pretty good impact, and I'm laying there on my back and making sure that I was still alive in my dream, and I was. And so then I tried to get up, and when I was trying to get up, it was like this tarry, muddy substance that I was laying in, and I struggled, and I couldn't get up, to the point of total exhaustion. Wrestled with it. I mean, I'm a fighter, and I wrestled, and I didn't give up, and I kept trying to get up, and I was totally exhausted, and then I just gave up. And as soon as I gave up, God said, be still and know that I am God. And he began to speak with me and show me and give me direction on what I needed to do to get right, that I was being disobedient to his discipline, and this was the final discipline if I didn't get it right. Of course, I did. I'm not that dumb. I may not be that sharp, but I'm not that dumb. So, however we rebel against God, discipline, God says, okay, I'm just going to, you know, ratchet up a notch until you wake up, until you hit bottom. And so I want to get your complete attention. And so that's what he did. And I really believe that something similar to this discipline is happening in America right now. That was taking place in the book of Ezekiel with the southern kingdom. God's been disciplining us for turning our backs on him, you guys, as a nation. And on top of that, the church in America has been silent about the sins of our nation for many years. Silence in the pulpit across the land, and it's allowed false prophets to rise up claiming what's going on in America right now. There's all kinds of people claiming to be prophets, saying that this isn't from God, that God's going to jump in any moment now and fix everything. I hope he does. But I'm having a hard time with that perspective, because my Bible says things like this in Revelation chapter 3:19. If you go to that slide, it says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Have we as a nation repented? It appears to me not so much. And that's why it's important for us to come out on Friday night prayer, because most of our prayer time is pointed towards our nation and the sins that we've been involved in, and our governments, and we pray for our state and our city and our church. And so it's important that the people of God stop being silent and we pray. And when I see people getting crazy and violent out there in the public because of the possibility of Roe versus Wade being overturned, it's just like, how can they be so crazy about wanting to abort babies? And look how some are even wanting to ramp up the abortion laws where you can take baby's life after it's already born. Sick. And when I see the indoctrination of our children in the public schools being exposed to sexually immoral things in elementary schools, I say, we have not made things right with God. And I believe we're under His disciplinary action. Will we wake up? I don't know. I hope so. Hebrews 12:11 says, "For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it." In Job 5:17, it says, "Behold, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore, despise not the discipline of the Almighty." Just food for thought, you guys, about what's going on in America. I mean, in many ways, it sort of parallels, you see, with what was going on in Judah during Ezekiel's time. Amen? I hope you're seeing this. King Zedekiah was disposing the discipline of the Almighty God. And God says, okay, if that's what you want to do, then this is what's going to happen. Next slide. So remember what it says in verse 6. Its branches turned towards him. It's referring to the king of Egypt, remember, that its branches turned towards him, and its roots remained where it stood. So its roots stayed there in Judah, but its branches turned towards Egypt. So it became a vine, and it produced branches and put out boughs or boughs. And when you look up that word boughs, you're going to discover that these are branches that were good for nothing except to be burned in fire. That's what the vine was turning out to become, because it no longer sought after God. It sought after the king of Egypt in place of God. That this king of Egypt was going to save them somehow. Verses 7 and 8. And there was another great eagle. Now, This eagle is the king of Egypt that it's referring to. With great wings and much plumage, and behold, this vine bent its roots towards him and shot forth its branches towards him from the bed where it was planted, that he might water it. So in other words, that he might give them, as I said earlier, horses and chariots and military strength. And in verse 8, it goes on to say, "And it had been planted on good soil by abundant waters, that it might produce branches and bear fruit and became a noble vine." To become a noble vine. But God is saying that he gave this vine, speaking of Judah, everything that it needed. Even though they were being disciplined, he was still taking care of them. May not have been what they wanted or expected from God, but he was still taking care of them. God says that he was giving them everything that they needed, but instead they reached out to the king of Egypt. Verses 9 and 10 say, "Thus says the Lord God, will it thrive? Will he not pull up its roots and cut off its fruit so that it withers, so that all of its fresh sprouting leaves wither? It will not take a strong arm or many people to pull it from its roots. Behold, it is planted. Will it thrive? Will it not utterly wither? Then when the east wind strikes it, wither away on the bed where it is sprouted?" So God is speaking through Ezekiel here, and he's telling them, remember, he's telling the people a story because he wants them to understand what's happening. So he's speaking through Ezekiel, and he's telling them the blessing that was given to them will now be pulled away from them, and they will not survive. Even Zedekiah would die because of his decision-making process. Verses 11 through 15. "And then the word of the Lord came to me, Say now to the rebellious house, do you not know what these things mean? Tell them, behold, the king of Babylon came to Jerusalem, and he took her king, that's Zedekiah, and her princes, and brought them to him to Babylon, and he took one of the royal offspring. Remember that he brought Ezekiel in the invasion of Jerusalem. He took people captive, and in that captivity was Ezekiel and Daniel and Daniel's friends. You know, he took these royal offspring and brought them back into Babylon. It says, and made a covenant with him, putting him under oath. He made a covenant with that king, Zedekiah, that the kingdom might be humble and not lift itself up and keep his covenant that it might stand. But he rebelled against him by sending his ambassadors to Egypt that they might give him horses and a large army. Will he thrive? Can one escape who does such things? Can he break the covenant and yet escape? Of course, the answer to that is no. Absolutely no. And God has Ezekiel explain the meaning of this allegory to them so that they could not give the excuse that they didn't understand what that was going on was all about. Are you guys with me so far? So on the next slide, there are seven things that you should know. If you have your cell phones with you should pull them out, take a picture of this, or try to write these down. But there are seven things that you should write down. Because it's going to help you remember why all this happened to the people in the land of Judah. See, if you can't connect the dots, I should say I want you to try to connect the dots with what's been happening to us in America here during this day that we're living in to what is going on in that day in Judah. Try to do that. So number one, the first great eagle represented the king of Babylon. Number two, Lebanon represented Jerusalem. Number three, the highest branch of the cedar represented Judah's king, Jehoiakim, until replaced by Zedekiah. Number four, the first eagle, Nebuchadnezzar, made a covenant with Zedekiah and put him under oath. Number five, the first eagle, Nebuchadnezzar, took the land captive and all the noble men, such as Daniel and his friends, who eventually got tossed into the fiery furnace for not bowing to the golden statue. Number six, Nebuchadnezzar took them to Babylon, which was called the City of the Merchants. Number seven, the vine stretched out its roots and branches towards the second eagle, and King Zedekiah rebelled by sending his ambassadors to Egypt. So if you can remember these, it's going to help you understand where we've been so far. And as we continue through the book of Ezekiel, it's going to help you remember what's going on and help you have a better understanding in the future as we study through this book. Now I'm going to ask you to read verses 16 through 21. At home. I'm going to skip those in here because they're kind of repetitive. But if you remember when we first began this study through the book of Ezekiel, I said the Holy Spirit led me to do this verse-by-verse teaching through it because there's much parallelism with what is going on in America in the day that you and I are living in, which is with what's going on there at this time. That we're reading of Ezekiel's life. And so the Holy Spirit is who led me. I do verse-by-verse teachings occasionally. I do other types of teaching or preaching along the way over the years, but God led me to do this, to break it down verse-by-verse. So hopefully you're learning and growing and learning as we go through this. So it's not only about what's going on in America right now, but it's also throughout the entire world. We see the whole world involved in strange things and strange affairs right now. We have never experienced such a time as this in my lifetime. And so, as we conclude chapter 17, you could say it's a very negative chapter, and rightfully so. He's using this chapter in a parable form to make them aware of this attempt to rebel against his disciplinary hand. And he's simply saying that it's not going to work, and your plan will not supersede my plan. Zedekiah is going to completely fail, and he's even going to lose his life over his choices. How many of us understand that no man's plans, no matter how wealthy you may be, no matter what position or office that you may hold, no matter what, no man's plans can ever supersede God's plans. Amen? If you believe in God's plan, which has already been laid out for us in this book, that's why you need to read your Bible every day. If you believe in God's plan, then all the plans of the wicked shall come to naught, because they are in rebellion against God. And if you're in rebellion against God, that's a sad place to be. Folks, that's why these historical stories in the Bible are there to build our faith and trust in God. We're not the only nation that's ever gone through a difficult time. And so God gives us this literature, these stories that are God-breathed, so that we could study them out and that we could see what to do, what not to do, how to react in these difficult times. Are you with me on that? No man's plans can or ever will supersede God's plans. That's why these stories are there, to give us faith and hope and confidence, because God always wins. Turn to the person next to you and say, God always wins. Now turn to the person on the other side and say, God always wins. Amen. Now, God ends this chapter on a positive note, so let's look at verse 22, and here's what it says. It says, thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar and will set it out. So now he's speaking of King Jesus that comes out of the Davidical line. Let me read that again. I myself, now God, he's taken control now. He says, I've had enough of your foolishness. He says, now I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of the cedar and will set it out. He's speaking of King Jesus here that comes out of the Davidical lineage, from the root of Jesse. Are you with me? And he says, I will break off from the topmost of its young twigs a tender one. A tender one is the Messiah, the son of David. And I myself will plant it on a high, lofty mountain. Most likely it's speaking of Mount Zion here. And a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. I might add that this is Ezekiel's version of Isaiah's prophecy in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. Let me just read that to you real quick. And here's what it says. It says, where it says, there shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse. Amazing, right? So out of what was thought to be dead, this vine, remember, it was good for nothing. Its boughs were good for nothing except to be burned and thrown into a fire. So out of what was thought to be dead, God promised to bring forth this wonderful, productive growth. He says, I myself am going to make this happen. You guys can't. I've given you opportunity after top opportunity to be obedient to my discipline so that you will grow and be able to make this happen. You have failed Now, I'm taking over, and I myself will do it, and I'm going to bring forth this wonderful, productive growth. He's making that promise. Isn't that what God does? Out of something dead. He takes dead things and he brings them to life. Amen, church? He did it with you and he did it with me. We were once dead in our trespasses and sins. We once walked following the ways of this world. And God woke us up and he took us from being dead and stuck in the muck and the mire like I was. And he raised us up and he set us on a rock so that we can be free from all of that garbage that the world and the devil wants to put on us. Amen. In Ezekiel chapter 17, verse 23, it says, on the mountain heights of Israel will I plant it, that it may bear branches and produce fruit and become a noble cedar. Again, he's speaking of the Messiah. And under it will dwell every kind of bird in the shade of its branches. Birds of every sort will nest. God is saying that here, at this place, here, that the nations of the world will be gathered under the promised King, King Jesus. It's a heavenly place. God says, I myself will plant it. I will do it. He makes that promise to us, you guys. He made it to them. He's making it to us. On the high mountain where it will grow and attract the birds of the air because its branches grow and they produce much fruit. We really need to understand that when a nation looks to God for its strength and for its guidance in governing itself, when a nation does that, then happy are the people who frame their policies by consulting in Him. Think about it. America was once like that, and, you know, that's why we lived for so many years under the blessings of God. The week before last, I met with the superintendent of schools in the Menifee School District concerning an issue with some of the elementary school textbooks, one in particular that they were using for history. How many of you know that the LGBT community and the teachers' union has infiltrated the system by paying off politicians and campaigning for them? The repercussion of that is that the politicians then pass bills that are put forth because of the finances that come into their campaigns. Corrupt. And so they are writing and producing some of the worst textbooks that you can ever imagine. So I was sent a copy of a page out of a third grade text that was being used in our city's third grade history class. And in it was, they were giving praise, this textbook was giving praise to a gentleman by the name of Harvey Milk. Do you know who he is? You should look him up because I don't have time to tell you about him. So of all the great historical figures that they could be talking about, this text uses Harvey Milk. So I approached Dr. Root and one of the other members of the school board. I had a private meeting with him and I said, you know, I'm concerned about this book and why you're allowing this to be used in third grade and fourth grade to teach our kids about Harvey Milk and gender, multiple gender identities and homosexuality and all this stuff. I said, you know, we love the homosexual, but we hate the sin. I'm not here to hammer on homosexuals. We love them, but we hate the sin that they're participating in, and it should not be taught to an 8-year-old. An 8-year-old does not wake up in the morning wondering what gender he or she might be today. An 8-year-old doesn't wake up naturally in the morning thinking about whether they're attracted to a male or a female. It's not natural. They're taught that, and now they're being taught that in our schools, public school system. So I said, you know, there's a war going on, and it's between good and evil, Dr. Root. And I said, I'm on the side of good. And so the reason I'm here is because I'm putting a check on what's being taught in the school district. And I don't think this is appropriate material to be teaching a third grader. So the state of Sacramento sends to Riverside County School District 4 books that they can choose from. Well, our school district chose the least offensive book. You wouldn't believe what's in the other one. And so these are all come from Sacramento, as I said earlier, because of what's going on with their campaigns and all that kind of stuff. And then I said, Dr. Root, while discussing it with her, I'm curious why for years every school board meeting was opened with prayer by one of the Menifee pastors until 2020, and I understand in 2020 because all the meetings were virtual meetings. Nobody could go there in person. They were all done online, and now that they are opened up to the public again, there is no prayer or blessing spoken over the school board. Why is that? We did it for years. And her answer was separation of church and state. They're afraid of a lawsuit. And so moving on, I'm going to close with this. Ezekiel chapter 17, verse 24. And all the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree and make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. Isn't that God? He says, I am the Lord and I have spoken and I will do it. So we see here God ending chapter 17 with a very positive prophecy. I will do it. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to speak life into the dead thing, and I'm going to bring it to life. But I'm going to take this which is flourishing, and I'm going to cause it to die. Because that which is flourishing is not following God, based upon this teaching. And you know, he says, because of his dealings with kings such as Zedekiah, along with his future work through the Messiah, God will exalt himself amongst all the nations, you see. As the songwriter wrote, even though we don't see him working, he's working. Amen? God is on the throne, you guys, and he governs the universe from there. And there is no escape from him. Even though we don't see him working, he's working. The Bible says that God works in the darkness. Even in your darkest day, God is working. Even though you don't see him, he's working. Chapter 17 began with judgment and punishment, and it ends with mercy and grace. Amen? Turn to somebody and say, that's my God.